Good evening, everyone. What a beautiful crowd you are. Look at all these people. We're, you know, how many days into, 28 days into National Poetry Month, and we're going strong. This is fantastic. It is so nice to see you all here tonight. My name is Michelle Singer. I'm the co-coordinator of Poem City here at the Kellogg Hubbard Library in the city of Montpelier. Poem City is Montpelier's way to celebrate National Poetry Month, and we do it in grand style. And you can see just around us, the big signs here are the poetry that we had on buses last year. Green Mountain Transit Agency, the local routes all had a poem on them. Around the walls are the poetry of fourth graders from East Montpelier Elementary School. Mm-hmm. They're wonderful, check them out. So I work with Rachel Seneschal of the Kellogg Hubbard Library. She's the program and development coordinator, and this is her baby. Poem City is her baby, and we thank her for it every year. Poem City is sponsored by the National Life Group Foundation, the Vermont Humanities Council, the Hunger Mountain Co-op, Goddard College, and the Vermont College of Fine Arts. We are very grateful to all of them for allowing us to present 35 programs this month. Readings, workshops, presentations, all on poetry. Poem City is displaying 400 poems by Vermonters at 100 venues in downtown Montpelier this year. The poets range in age from 6 to 91, and in experience from our poet laureate, our Vermont poet laureate, to first graders writing their first poems. Tonight, I am very happy to welcome Baron Wormser and Kate Farrell. Baron Wormser is a past poet laureate of Maine, the author and co-author of numerous books, most recently in poetry, Impenitent Notes, and in prose, Teach Us That Peace. Writer and actress Kate Farrell has been working in poetry, art, and theater in New York for over 3 decades, and her most recent book is Visiting Night at the Academy of Longing. We're so happy to have them here tonight. One little bit of business, the restroom is in the back of the room on the left. If you need anything, I will be here. If you need a drink of water, anything you need, I'm here. We will also have books available for purchase and signing afterwards. So please help me in welcoming Kate Farrell to the podium.
Thank you so much for coming. Let's see if I'm heard well, everything's okay. Thank you, Michelle. The first poem I'll read is entitled Four Quartets, and it's a dream poem where I meet the poet T.S. Eliot in the afterlife. I met T.S. Eliot in a dream last night. I'd gone to the afterlife to visit relatives, and he was stepping from a doorway, very preoccupied and serious. I went up and told him how much I admired Four Quartets, that it stood apart in the history of poetry, that I wished I could write a long poem of that stature. He said, "You can. Write 10 lines of impeccable honesty. The next day, 10 more, and so on until it's finished." He said he was revising Four Quartets, and I could almost see, given the altered vantage point, where the changes might be. Hearing he was about to read the latest draft aloud, I asked to stay and listen, and he agreed. They set me up a chair in the hull of a largish boat moored at the lakeside to undergo repairs. Eliot stood on the shore, facing the lake and me, the new Four Quartets in hand, and began to read. The next poem, South Florida Confessional Waltz, begins in the confessional of the chapel of the Catholic girls' school in Florida I attended for a couple of years. South Florida Confessional Waltz. Rising from my knees at 18, I exited the Florida confessional and pretty stucco chapel out into the balmy night under the soaring palms with moonlit fronds tossing in the ocean breeze, and said to myself, "I'm sorry, I should have said so before, but I can have nothing to do anymore with a deity on the lookout for slip-ups and lonely twosomes in mistaken embraces. No, unless there's a half-blind kindness to look up to, forget it. Hell's easier to forgive than a hard-line, small-minded heaven. Why I didn't see it before, I don't know. But a trace of pettiness annuls all interest. There has to be at least the mercy, mystery, vast-heartedness of those stars and trees, this wind, that dark sea, the deep-down yearning of the slow dance music drifting from that half-open dormitory door over there. Maybe not these exact words, but I suddenly knew what I meant. I said to myself, I'm sorry, I can have no part. The woman from the islands. Not till she dies do you love your mother as a mother a daughter. The priest had come and gone. We'd sung at her bedside the songs she'd sung us as kids. And after my brothers and weeping father went downstairs to wait, the young woman from the islands the home health agency sent showed my sister and me how to wash the body, told us of the need to give her time to leave it behind completely. And after the hearse drove back down the moonlit street, I rushed to the hotel, hurrying to sleep to look for her. Couldn't wait to see her. In the dreams, I went from room to room. It took a week to find her. The woman from the islands, having washed away all that obscured her first promise, pure, immense, and unmistakable as a little daughter's. Success, the name of the poem is Success. Success is a house with big white rooms, surrounded by gardens behind an iron gate. I used to go past it when I was a child, wishing I could someday walk through those gardens. The property belonged to a very rich old man, and one summer when his granddaughter came to visit, I was invited to her birthday party. The front door opened to a white marble fountain where a statue of a girl stood in a seashell, water splashing around her. Guests were taught rules no one wanted to know, for games no one wanted to play, then seated for lunch at a long, narrow table where women in aprons corrected their manners. And by the time my father arrived to take me home, I was a fidget away from being baked like the stone girl into the house of cake for twiddling her thumbs in the grand rotunda. The next few poems have to do with the time just after my first husband's suicide, when my kids were 3 and 5. This one's called The Ticket. The Ticket. One day, a few months after my husband's suicide, I was on my way to pick up the kids at nursery school when a cop pulled me over for doing 40 in a 25. "Did you happen to notice," he said, leaning down to my car window, "that this is a residential zone, the sort of neighborhood where parents like to think it's safe to let their kids play outside? Or can you not be bothered to look at the signs?" At which point, I burst out crying, and uncontrollable sobs, wildly disproportionate to the actual situation, precluded any answer. Tears flooded the ticket on the clipboard he put through the window for my signature, drenching his hands and shirt cuffs as he tore off a copy for me, by which time the blue ink of the date, name of street, town and state, violation code, amount of the fine, and other facts of the case, including the officer's name and mine, had slid from the ticket's tear-saturated boxes, spaces, and lines, and washed away indistinguishably together. This next one's entitled Afterlives, and it's a prose poem a couple of pages long. It moves around a bit, touching on the classes I was taking at the University of Oklahoma at the time, Jung's near-death experience, and how the Russian poet Marina Svetaeva fell in love with Rilke one summer via their poems and letters. Afterlives. My three-year-old grieved outright, said she wanted to go live in the grave with her father. Her brother at five, more circumspect, stopped us one day as we walked down the street. "Here's the middle of a story," he said, "with no beginning or end. A man died and was buried. His tongue turned to a seed, and a tree grew from it. Me, back in college, minus a compass, thoughts sinking from the rocks I put in their pockets, afraid to sleep like other people did, head neatly on a pillow under sheets in the dark, jittery to the bone, the stakes high, the kids not yet told it was a suicide. A fact never far from my mind. Would I walk the same plank? Let some mentally ill subself take the wheel and drive? After I started seeing things, I drove a time or two out to the Norman, Oklahoma subdivisions, where a psychotherapist recommended I give up on love and have some fun. But could it be done? Or was it like going along with the poetry professor's unsuspended disbelief, but with a secret ear out for a way to resuspend it? Or burying the feeling that the invisible self can't die beneath the opinion that it can, it must, but with the feeling beneath, still alive and breathing? Jung thought dreamers believe in the afterlife, whatever their waking minds think. Recommended that we learn to tell the actual dead from symbolic dream semblances. I think of Marina Svetaeva falling in love with Rilke that summer in their poems and letters, never knowing how sick he was, never meeting him. After he died, a dream tete-a-tete in a series of candlelit rooms reversed her ideas of life and death. Others go to the kitchen for a midnight glass of water and get a calm guest-like sense of more prestigious dimension right behind the paper-thin appliances. Jung once recounted a near-death experience in a fabulous setting 1,000 miles above the planet. Traveling in his primal form, he gladly shed the phantasmagoria of earthly comings and goings and was about to find out the secrets of existence when he was breathed back into his prior box-like life. Fears of the real thing are said to dwindle after such a preview, so in tune are its high hoped-for reaches with forest epiphanies knelt before childhood candles and the different luckier thing Whitman swore death was, no matter what adult shopping consciousness has to say about it. Maybe also in tune with the songs your mother sang as she cooked and cleaned, hinting why you too would want to have children with someone whose eyes light up at your sight. Then one day, there they are, in their beguilingly tiny, soft rental bodies, with the gathering question of whether the one with the lit up eyes has disappeared forever. By the time mine cornered me, I was a stubbornly unread makeshift agnostic, not about to let on what I half thought, that were party balloons with our names on them, as good as gone from the start, drifting bossily around before it snagging deflated on a twig beside a pond. Nor could I as yet say that their father and the rest of us were deathless beings on interlinking missions. Love, the ticket back to each other. Bodily matter, our least versatile set of clothes. No, no, my maybe this, maybe that, fell from a realm so much drabber and smaller than their question of questions that I followed along ever after with my pencil cup of solaces, a street beggar who doesn't know when to stop. But that was later. Back at the beginning, a day or two after telling a story, my son asked, "How do we know trees don't think? Maybe they're all dreaming." At which the buried man began to toss and turn and talk in his sleep, and winter branches gesticulate like apostles with the gift of tongues, and the town sound turned off. And when leaves came back to Oklahoma that spring, rustling just this side of talk, I was half ready on lonely, strangely beautiful in memory, twilights in the park, to whisk, if need be, the kids out of earshot. I'm just going to get a bit of water. Okay, there it goes next. In this poem, sparked by a dream, I'm visiting my kids at the Academy of Longing, where they'd been automatically enrolled at the death of their father. Visiting night at the Academy of Longing. A mild night on the grounds, windows glimmering here and there in dark foliage, with lights less identifiable, far away and nearer by, as stray visitors on side paths walk off useless yearnings or trade old North Stars for new. Climb the steps to the enormous library, silent, but for the soft shuffle of paper and our own footsteps and whispers. Students at the table barely look up, each given over to some irrescindible, one of a kind, wide as the world set of ponderings. I find my two at a low table, no older than at their arrival years before, but with that preternatural calm you see in portraits of child saints, in one hand, a flower, book, bird, miniature castle, ladder, boat, or other symbol to hint how the apotheosis came about. I beg them to come back home with me, promising that this time things will be happier and easier. They exchange a glance of embarrassed sympathy and pity. "Would I like them to show me around?" they ask. "I could even stay. There are thousands of pasts after all. Time, an ocean, chances like waves. Did I notice those lights that look like windows in space as I came up the main walkway?" The next poem begins in one of those two-story dollhouses whose open back wall allows a child to reach in and move the furniture and people around. The poem is preceded by two epigraphs, one from the Upanishads, one from the Song of Solomon. Lullaby of the Miniature Past. Smaller than the small, vaster than the vast, hidden in the heart, here is the self. Katha Upanishad. I slept, but my heart was awake. Song of Solomon. Reaching through the house wall, the girl is the mother who carries the child upstairs to bed, or moves a chair from here to there, as though this or that adjustment might stir to life the galaxy out the toy back window. A poem, too, has walls to break through, a half-known story it almost mystically holds you to. For years on end, not this, not that, word, line, mood, attitude. Then one summer night, a word like breeze shifts from there to here and lands you in a room where a little girl is sleeping. How deep the game? How to explain? For the room is in a house, on a street in a town, which happens to sit on a vast whirling globe, where time rolls one way, space rushes another, in a collapsing instant of vanishing thinking. Lamps by the millions switch off and on, and all kinds of doors close and open as promises, people, intentions come and go in so many cul-de-sacs of stranded longing that all would be lost if the past weren't a house with one wall open, where lives suffuse, rearrange, make sense of one another. Its location, a quiet side street in the sleeping girl's heart, thousands of summer night twinkling in its minuscule windows. This is called Poem for Dan's Departure and is addressed to my son Dan. I handed him the first draft of it one day in his early 20s as he set out for California. He now lives here in Montpelier and is here tonight. Poem for Dan's Departure. So much do we love talking to people we love, about ideas we love, that thinking itself keeps the conversation going. What luck that ours got so early a start, adding such a bright star to the constellation of conversations I seem to be becoming. For however far apart we are, your considerate voice stays with me, altering every interchange, mental or spoken. You once told me you thought that every person on earth had the part of the truth you needed. I wish I could give you Perseus's compass, helmet, sandals, and shields to take along with you, to search out the pieces and put them back together in ways all your own. I wish you'd call me from time to time and tell the part of me that's you where your part of the conversation is going. The search. Then the moon comes up after all, and with a glow bright enough to wake you through the bedroom curtains, the night outside, one vast, luminous room, beside which indoor rooms seem to belong to a preliminary, rudimentary dimension. And her there shining, mother, daughter, friend, anima mundi, so still and low it's almost as though you hadn't broken every vow you ever made in the wayside tabernacles of the cosmos behind the forehead. Go back to bed. Close your eyes. Resolve this time to make it through to the other side of the dark. Find a place to set up shop. Work without let up by the light love supplies, rid at last of mental fuss. Soon, you're walking down a deserted road through a nighttime countryside, wondering if one of the locals is acquainted with the lesser known lunar writings. Houses are few. Everyone's asleep. The air suffused with a beautiful half light whose source you can't place. You're strangely unafraid and in no hurry. The stream. Through the woods out my window is a stream whose distant windings bring to mind the mythic town, which, so the story goes, appears for just one day every 100 years, and into whose apparition a stranger from this world happens on one such day to wander. In the version I remember, the question on which the story turns is this: will he remain with the beautiful townswoman with whom he fell in love on that astonishing morning, returning with her and her town to who knows where exactly, or not? Likewise, my stream can only be seen from a particular window for a short while on certain mornings, when a perfect angle of illumination all at once reveals a flashing galaxy of winding light way off in the depths of dark hemlocks. Maybe one day I'll go back with it to the place it comes from, a stranger called by love to a disappearing town. Three poems for Bob, meaning my husband Bob, The first of the three is entitled A Mood in a Room. A Mood in a Room. Seeing couples fight and show off for each other, you think love will be a breathtaking, heartbreaking commotion in and around you, which then will fade to boredom and blame. So, who dares dream of finding a combined state of mind in which excitement is peaceful, peace exciting? To be regarded as kindly as you regard me is a treatise in solace, calming the clamor I once considered the very essence of me. I could toss away the wilted bouquet of interesting people I thought I should be. That too you picked up and put into water. Maybe everyone ideally wakes another in the others, every two different from every other two, each a latent crossroad of grateful multitudes, but almost as thrilling as the voice of the tomb, which tells your weeping sisters you'll live after all, is the silent poésie à deux of two who've been in love for 20 or 30 years after the guests have gone. The second one is dated 8-8-88, which was the date of our marriage. Double bubble, 8-8-88. The night before the day of our wedding, I dreamed the universe had a party. All the stars were invited. Beneath resplendent chandeliers, the galaxies rejoiced. Millions of glass-clinking revelers crowded high summer terraces, laughing and talking all night in every variety of light. Opening a kitchen drawer, a love poem. A bunch of ordinary things we use for this and that. I have everything I have ever wanted. Revenant. To open your closet on a January morning and see your clothes hanging there, as on the day you die, those you love will see them, lopsided, inside out, sagging from their hangers, the last pitiful remnants of a lifetime of struggles, many if not most, futile if not silly, all of them flawed and unfinished, then to walk alive out into the streets as the sun turns newsstands gold and skyscrapers rose, and to wait in the subway station where someone you can't see is whistling First Noel out of season, then climb the stairs as upswirls of snow from limbs and ledges light the air with igniting ice, then rain around you in gusts aglow with vanishing spangles of wedding rice. Yet another dream poem, this one entitled Metaphysics. Metaphysics. For a while after he died, my father didn't seem to discern dream visitors, but I was amazed nonetheless to witness his swift and serene rejuvenation. From time to time, I'd find him dining outdoors in beautiful locales, a multicolored grain on his plate I'd never seen elsewhere. Yes, laughed the server. It's a staple here, a sort of national dish, I guess, like potatoes in Ireland, pasta in Italy, couscous in Morocco, rice in Japan or Madagascar. We can't get enough of it, and it's remarkably nutritious. What's it called? I ask. She replied, metaphysics. In this last one, the stopover, wood ducks on a pond at dawn inspire a more entrancing, mysterious way of living and dying. The stopover. Wood ducks in the pond at dawn, 14, 16 flashing wings of a dozen more, even the overnight ice island's gold. Pond glitter ribbons the base of the abandoned beaver hut and other shabby areas slated for apotheosis, and the crisscrossing wakes of the little ducks are sparkling trains of queens with no yen for dominion who prefer we change our ways or leave the forest. We could start by trying their more direct route from and to light, growing older by becoming less and less visible, a slow molting, noticeable mostly toward the last. Your grown kids, secretly mesmerized when they'd come home to visit, startled to brush against absences, imagining their turn, like migrant birds, landing and swimming past each other, in and out of sight in the early glare of mists and pond reflections. Later, they'd recount with awe the end of it, how they'd arrived there one day, and after a wonderstruck glance, their way. By then, a matter of a stray lumen or two. You'd flown off with the others, as if at a signal. Thank you.
Join me in welcoming Baron Wormser.
Thank you. Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here tonight and to read with such a wonderful poet. I was reading, I'm doing a workshop in a few weeks in Washington, D.C., and it's going to be devoted to James Baldwin, someone I've been reading for decades. And I was reading a long essay by Baldwin, which I'm sure some of you know, No Name in the Street. And parenthetically, in the course of that essay, he says that, writes that a poet must, and I quote, excavate and recreate history. And I thought, oh, that's what I've been doing for decades. But no one had ever quite put it that way to me. So I thought I'd begin tonight very specifically with a poem that's very much about history. I'm reading tonight from what is actually my most recent book, which is called Unidentified Sighing Objects, and which is a painting by my wife, Janet, on the cover. Hey, Janet. And this book is dedicated to her, as have a number of my books. I've lost track by this point in time. So this poem is called Two Places. Paris, France, 1940. A little man, no one you'd notice normally, hops up and down. Behind loom stone buildings, Paris is his. Once kings and cardinals decreed magnificence, who knows how many were crushed or fell. Those graves are ancient. The bells of Europe darkly knell. People flee on bikes and wagons and cars and trains. People walk as quickly as they can. Who knows how many days remain? Once the little man stood outside of history, muttering, gnashing his hatred, singly bent on overcoming. Once such a little man would have been crushed by kings and cardinals and their buildings. Now he is the shrieking star of destiny. Two, South Paris, Maine, 1944. A slightly stooped farmer in a flannel shirt and suspenders stands beside the post office and breathes in the tang of an autumn morning. Wood smoke and frost, winter coming. No letter from Robert Jr. 3 weeks, The farmer knows everyone on this street, and they know him. He wanders over to Vi's for coffee and maybe a slice of apple pie. He always liked pie in the morning after milking, something to sink his teeth into. People ask him if he's gotten a letter. He doesn't blame them. He rests his chin in his palm, then sips black Sanka slowly, avoids the newspaper. He knows his history. The title poem comes from a poem in here. There are a number of odes in here. This is called Ode to George Hanson. In the movie Easy Rider, Jack Nicholson plays a small town lawyer, early Jack Nicholson, who is, let's say, somewhat troubled. And this is about George Hanson. If you don't remember the movie, things do not turn out well. And in the movie, Jack meets Dennis Hopper and Peter Fonda, has on this varsity sweater with a big M on the front of it. Ode to George Hanson. The M on his varsity sweater stands for meaningful, means overeducated small town lawyer, means ingratiating pain in the butt boozer, means understands the word irony, means buried above ground, but lurching through the days, one pint to another, calendar of non-coincidences. Means he looks up at the midnight sky of unidentified sighing objects, beckoning to drunken small town lawyers wearing their varsity sweaters and waiting for the earth to turn in a different direction, waiting for someone in Muleville to say something semi-smart. M stands for mom, marijuana, Malthusian, momentary. This small town lawyer tossed in the clink, who scowled for his own good, where he meets two LA hippies and splits in search of the freedom, which he knew without consulting any mystic text or atlas was not in Louisiana, but somewhere inside him, maybe next to his spleen or in back of his head, where he can't see, which was all the better, and called for a drink. Man has a beautiful legal smile, charm money out of wallets, women out of their clothes, rain out of the clouds, but he blew it, pouring bourbon on his shrewd thirst, waking up in the clink, looking around, only half bewildered, still on earth, unlevitated by the Venusians in their sighing objects. George Hanson, small town, upright, derelict lawyer, buried above ground, but walking and talking and stalking a good time. Beaten, lynched, burned, shot, blown up. Sitting around the campfire with two LA hippies explaining freedom. Lecturing the roaming lights in the night. The intelligent ones who live among us but must be silent. When I was growing up, one thing I grew up with for a while was the Beatles. And they used to play in these big stadiums. And the stadiums were filled largely with young women, all of whom seemed to be losing their minds. And that was pretty great. And that sound is still with me. So I wrote this poem decades later, which has a kind of fancy title. It's called Syllabic Dithyrambs. Syllabic means poets write in syllabics that count syllables. Dithyramb is a Dionysian song, a dark song. And it has a subtitle, which is much more comprehensible. Shea Stadium, 1965. The deep sky broods. The ground shakes. Girl women cry. The Fab Four have a date. Rocked out shrieks. Time ending. Orgasmic sighs. Girl women cry. Terror like joy. Girl women cry. Transfixed, sort of die. Girl women cry. Tear their clothes, pull their hair. Faint, but rise. Mouths distended by eros. Girl women cry. A pagan rite. Electrified, virgin lust, untouched ache. Girl women cry. Free, but not free. Girl women cry. Take me, satyrs, take me. And they went home and had dreams. This is another ode. I love to write about the glories of this nation. And so this is called Ode to Basketball. It takes place in an urban setting, a lot like where I grew up, Baltimore. There are five characters in here, two guys playing ball, a German who's here visiting, guy in a wheelchair, and then this woman who's involved with one of the guys. There's some German in here, but I've translated it. Ode to basketball. Don't bring that weak shit into my kitchen, P-Man tells Spice, as the latter tries to drive right with no space. Only his unemployed will at work in the urban twilight where Werner strolls and broods about his homeland, and how he wants to return and doesn't, ambivalent as an ambidextrous point guard swinging the ball left, right, psyching out his opponent and himself. Unlike the guy in the wheelchair watching these proceedings and saying to all averted eyes, my body is a broken temple. As P-Man arcs a jumper over Spice's long arms that bounces off the back of the rim, one more misplaced thought in a galaxy of them. Like his longing for Sonia, who keeps telling him he needs to get his shit together, which is what he's trying to do when he plays ball, except she thinks ball is play stuff for kids, not men and women. While Werner sends home emails each day about the game in the asphalt park and how America is the home of the homeless, which is his way of saying he can't go home because there's something hopeless yet earnest, hoffnungslos aber ernsthaft, keeping him here, that goes beyond the guy in the wheelchair who's become a friend of sorts, both of them kibitzing about how Spice is gaining, how he's learning to move without the ball, the way the coaches tell you instead of standing around and waiting for shit to happen. A waste of time, according to Sonia, who is studying fashion design and intends to change at least one world. Paris, Milan, New York, outstretched at her non-sneakered feet. Or so she tells P-Man after they have sex and are lying on his thin mattress in his sad, broken window shades bedroom, just as he starts to boogie off to sleep to dream of the NBA, launching himself over bodies, benches, arenas, headed for something like glory. That not being a word he uses in his daily parlance, it being a word someone like Werner is prone to, missing as ein Deutscher does those centuries that brayed and cantered in the presence of majesty a homeland, eine Heimat, that he can pine for safely, since it won't be his warrior grave that time won't salute. It won't be his sense of how shooting fowls on a Wednesday afternoon is okay, as anything and better than most, the sky of vexed cloud jumble, and the air unhealthy but ripe with that city tang of bus exhaust and bustling bodies, emitting little doses of perspiring feeling like stutter steps towards some distant emotional hoop, like a fashion designer standing before a cadre of cameras and smiling a real fake smile and thinking of some guy she knew once, how she loved him and how he never got off his ass, even though he could leap through the air and seem to fly. But there was no place to fly to, no homeland, no wheelchair, no nothing, only a ball. Okay, let's stay in this downbeat mode. I mean, what's poetry for, right? So I want to read a poem called Two Failed Marriages. In her dream, two men sit at a bare table. Mr. First starts complaining, but about what? Something about a rubber duck. He's lost his rubber duck. And someone, he draws himself up when he says this, like a taut vertical elastic. Someone is going to pay for this. Mr. Second Husband sneers politely. You have to look carefully because he doesn't seem to possess anything as accomplished as a face. He doesn't talk. Instead, frog-like oofs issue from his chest. Yes, there is a big mouth in his chest between his nipples. Suddenly, the table begins to levitate. The rubber duck man claps with abrasive glee. The oofer pretends nothing is happening. Then a bewitched candle is floating through what must be air, though no one is breathing or laughing or crying or singing or anything. Okay, I'm going to read another ode. This country, as you know, is based on two tragedies, which is the murder of the native peoples and slavery. This is called Ode to the Ghost Dancer. Some of you may know this. In the latter part of the 19th century, Plains Indians, there was a religious movement among them, part of which was his dance, the ghost dance, which was basically to make the white people disappear and to bring back the buffalo. And the ghost dancers danced and danced and danced to exhaustion. It's truly heartbreaking when you see photographs of this and just think about it, basically. So this is called Ode to the Ghost Dancers. I'm very fond, as you may already have noticed, of collisions, bringing things together in time that weren't there in time. But as a poet, excavating and recreating history, I could bring them together. Ode to the Ghost Dancers. Busy with time, I forget out of time. How to recall the stars shuffle in their recondite heaven. To hear them, I must be still. To hear them, I have to open my beleaguered head. How much money did I make today? The spirits watch and grimace. Thousands of Indians shuffle their feet, a thin yet supple sound. If you stand outside Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer, the shilling hearts of the fluorescent republic, and are very still, above the cars starting, people prattling, radios broadcasting, you can feel the tremor of moccasin feet, shuffling, not stopping, dancing past exhaustion, past hope and hopelessness, to a place out of time, but in life. The concise moments of crickets, beavers, buffalo on a lush prairie, ravens talking. Have you seen the Indians? They are almost all dead, but they have plenty of ghosts. No ghosts for sale in Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer. Only those hungry ghosts buying 12 packs of paper towels, extra sauce, signature twill shirts, chanting Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer. Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer. Walmart, Taco Bell, Eddie Bauer. I forget how many died for this. How many were scalped, eviscerated, speared, arrowed? Their ghosts are angry too. But the Indians continue to dance. The troops ride into the encampment at Wounded Knee and start shooting. Screams, many screams. Everyone moves on. Nothing comes back. But like sun and clouds and stars, the spirits are undeterred. They hear the shuffling feet, the cries that pierce the squander of grief. Okay, a couple more. Call it an evening. Poets are people who are obsessed with all kinds of form, and the older the better often. So this poem is based on Old English, which peaked around, what, 1100 or something? I don't know. It's alliterative. You'll hear it. You'll hear a lot of sound in here. It's called Haircut, 1956. Another excavation and recreation. Men must be mundane, their virile vanity veiled in crew cuts, critique of hair, head honed to thin thrust of follicles, fine flat land, extreme the empty edge, but Bob the barber, sharpened shears, shook ample aprons, aim tonic and talk TV, Ike, illness, invasions of countries by communist killers, while the wealth of weeks fell formlessly, the fix of lessened locks lightly combed, the cunning clack and whack, whelming, wavy sensuousness, Samson's strength, beggared, bound, buzzed. Wish my childhood barber was still in the world. Would have loved to pass that on to. Let's end with this one. I'm going to dedicate this to my sister Sherry, who's here tonight. This is another ode. And I want to dedicate this to a student of mine. I teach in a low residency MFA program, not here, but in Connecticut. And I get a phone call this morning that one of my students, who was a little younger than I, died in his sleep two nights ago. And I talked, as my wife could tell you, about every week with this guy the past couple months. And one thing that infinitely touched me about this man was that he's a fiction writer. but he took a workshop with me, and he got very involved writing haiku and just deeply touched. And one of the books he was reading at what now is the end of his life was a book of haiku by the African-American writer Richard Wright, which some of you may know. In the last year and a half of his life, Wright wrote haiku every day. He knew he was going to die, and that was his way of, you know, getting to that place of letting go. So thank you all for coming out this evening. This is called Ode to Speech. Still fumbling with words, as if attempted eloquence could preserve you in my backward sight, as if your death held other deaths at bay, I see you emerging from the old 88, a bandage on your head that the scarf you bought at Liberty of London on your one trip abroad doesn't quite cover, and you shrunken inside your winter coat and moving very slowly, tottering would be the word, though you were only 47 and trying to form a smile of some sort, a desperate smile, a smile to rid you of pain and the weariness that eats my very bones, a smile to show you were fighting back as you taught me to fight back when the world taunted me. You halted on the sidewalk as if to take in the cold breeze, as if after weeks away, weeks in a small white room, it was a pleasure, the raw January air, how it shoved and gnawed at a body's modest warmth. You looked around slowly, your neck creaking, it lately having done little more than prop up your cancer-besieged head, and tried to say something, maybe about the sky or house or our German shepherd lady who wagged her tail bravely. But no words came out, none. Only a rueful blankness, more of that stolid fumbling that was the ruin of each laugh and kiss and exclamation. You seemed bewildered to be there, to be alive, to be expected to respond when all that lay in front of you was your coming to a bed and waiting, patient and impatient for what the words, nothing more to be done, signified. You told me you'd overheard those words, one intern informing another. I love you all, you said, then on the sidewalk to the dog and your husband and us children, but you didn't smile. Your words were quiet and grave, like the words in a speech, but from the depths of words, their blind insides. Thank you.